things about water-wise gardening has a lot of names. There's a lot of names out there. And depending on what part of the country you have lived before, or even here in Dallas, you will find it called so many different names. And so it's very important that you understand about these names. A lot of times you hear xeriscape, and xeriscape has always gotten kind of this bad name. It's like, oh, I don't want that xeriscape. That's nothing but that cactus and rocks. I don't want that. And then you'll hear a term around here in North Texas called smartscape. Smartscape was something that was coined by the National Council of Governments here in North Texas. They have an entire program called Smartscape. They have a website called Smartscape. Then Austin, and in that area, they use the term water-wise, and they say water-wise gardening, and water-wise this, and water-wise that. And then there is, I think, TCEQ, another Texas agency, has got something called yard-wise, okay? So all of these terms, and everybody kind of gets really confused because they think each one of these kind of means something different. And then you notice we use the word sustainable on our landscape series. That's been the new buzzword. I will tell you, xeriscape has been around since 1980. It didn't really catch on here. It was coined by Denver. Denver Water, as a matter of fact, coined the term in 1980. But I will tell you that everybody kind of had to have their own version, and now Texas A&M has a version. The extension uses earth kind. Okay, so the reason why I'm telling you this is that you're going to see all of these terms out there, and I have to tell you that they really all mean the same. They are all exactly the same, and they are all on some certain principles that we're going to get on. Now, this is the thing, this was the original. Xeriscape was the original term, and this is the one that came out in 1980. And it came out when we were having severe droughts back in the 80s. So guess what? We have droughts, we have floods, we have droughts, we have floods. It's always going to be that way. And xeriscape got a bad rap because of its meaning. Xeros meaning dry, and scape meaning vista. So if xeriscape means dry vista, then that's where the cactus and the rock and the yucca, that's where it got its, that's where people really got confused. But xeriscape really, it just emphasizes water and energy conservation in the landscape. It's based on 7 principles that can be applied to any landscape. Now, when I say landscape, realize that's an all-encompassing term, because landscape is anything that's outside, all right? So this is the outside landscape. This is going to be things for your vegetable garden. This will be things for your flower gardens. This will be things for your yard. The principles are the same, and they go on these 7 principles. Now, this is what I'll tell you now, is that you go back and you look at the internet or whatever else after you leave here, and go and look up earth kind. Go and look up water-wise. Go and look up all of these terms. They're all going to say they're based on 7 principles. They won't say xeriscape, but they'll say they're based on 7 principles. And the 7 principles are exactly the same. Okay, so that's the thing that you need to know, is these principles. Planning and design, soil analysis and improvement, appropriate plant selection, practical turf areas, efficient irrigation, use of mulches, and appropriate maintenance. That is the 7 guiding principles for anything. Now, you can take out the turf if you're talking about vegetable gardens. You can take out that if you're talking about flower gardens. But the rest of them, the planting, the soil, the plant selection, the irrigation, the mulches, and maintenance apply to everything. So it applies even if you're talking about growing tomatoes in the backyard. Because if you don't plan for it, you're not going to have very good success for it. So, planning and design. What does that really mean? That really means that you don't go to the nursery and say, that's a cute plant, I think I'll pick that up and I'm going to put it right here by my front door. Because what happens with that is that sometimes you don't think about what that plant is going to look like when it's its mature size. And then also you think about it as, I like that in my front yard. Well, what if your front yard is facing north and it's shady, and this plant that you really like only will work in full sun, dry exposures? Naturally, it's not going to work there. It will for a little bit. You'll put it in the ground, and then you'll go, my plant died. I don't know why. That's just a bad plant. Well, it has nothing to do with the plant. It's about its exposure and where you put it. So any time that you're going to be doing anything, even if it's just a flower garden, even if it's a vegetable garden, even or if you're going to be renovating your entire landscape, then the first item you have to do is you have to go through this process. This is the most boring process that there is. One of my former students drawing out a landscape design back in Colorado. But I will tell you that this right here is very, very important, that you actually put it on paper. You don't have to be fancy like this. You don't have to have a drawing board. You can have a kitchen table and a piece of paper and a pencil. And really all you need to do is do X's and O's or whatever else, but you need to be doing it in a scale or at least something so that you know how much room you have. So if you know that your front flower bed, and maybe it's a bed that's this size, is 10 foot long and 5 foot wide, then that's the first thing that you need to gather. That's the first information. How large a space do I actually have? And from that space, what is going to be working in there? Now, the other thing is, as far as planning is you got to take consideration of the exposures. You've got to do that at the time that you're doing this planning. When you're actually doing all of this, you got to know, is this facing north? Is it facing south, east, west? Because each of those exposures is going to tell you what type of plant material can actually work that way. I have had people that put vegetable gardens, because they wanted it, back against their 8-foot wood fence. That's where they put their vegetable garden. However, they didn't take into consideration that that back fence was on the south. So therefore, they had this shade coming off of that fence all the time, because on the other side of the fence is north, and you get those shadows. And then they go, why are my tomatoes so spindly and bleh, and they just don't do anything? Well, because they have to have full sun, and they put them in a shade exposure. It's the same for any plant, whether we're talking vegetables, whether we're talking flowers, whether we're taking fruits, vegetables, turf grass, trees, shrubs, whatever, it's the same thing. So we're talking general plants. You have to know what is best for them. And looking at that cute little container is not telling you what's best for that plant. Unless it has a proper plant tag in it that then tells you. This plant, and I have to tell you the story of not planning. A friend of mine, she lives in Plano. She had what was glossy abelia, and you guys probably know that plant. It's a fairly large shrub. And when she moved into this new house, you know, it was kind of blocking the sidewalk that went into her front house. And so she said, oh, I'm going to re-landscape that. So her and her husband, they pulled it all out. They jerked it out. You know, they prepped the soil. They did everything. And then they planted cute little plants. And they said, come over. They want you to see my cute little plants. So I went over there, and what do you think that they had planted? Glossy abelia. They were cute little plants in that little nursery, but it was the exact same plant that they had just torn out. So Now, years later, it's grown up again, and it looks like it did when they moved in. So that's the thing. You have to really take into consideration all of those items. And most people don't know. I mean, they don't know. They're not trained horticulturists. They're not. This is something that they do for fun. They want to go out and they want to do this stuff, but they really don't know anything about it. And they go to the box stores, or they go someplace, and they don't ask, because heaven forbid that we ever ask anybody a question. We go in there and they just look at the stuff and they read the tags and they pick it up and they put it in their basket and then they go check out and then they go home and they get out the shovel and they just start digging and they just plant it all without ever taking any consideration. And that's where most people go wrong, especially here in North Texas, because we have a unique item in Texas. One thing that people usually don't take into consideration when they're doing landscape renovations is the irrigation. And especially here in Allen, most of the homes here in Allen have got automatic irrigation systems. They're already installed. And they're already, the heads are already there and things like that. And maybe you had turf grass in that area and now you're gonna put a vegetable garden. Well, you know, I can just leave that spray irrigation there and it's gonna get the vegetables. But no, you should not be doing that. You should realize that you need to be changing your irrigation as well, because different plants require different water. And some of the things that you'll see in some irrigations now that are done improperly, however you can correct it, or you can have an irrigator correct it for you, is that they should never be on the same zone together. So your turf grass and your shrubs should not be on the same zone. Your vegetable garden should not be on the same zone with your turf. Even if you take that spray head out and say, oh, I'm going to convert it and do something else, if it's coming on at the same time with your grass, that's wrong, because it requires different water. So we want, and I will tell you that to be honest, in most of the lawns around here, what we need is we need about 7 zones in a small yard minimum in like a 5,000 square foot landscape. And the reason why I'm saying that is because you also have to think about the exposure. First of all plants have to have different irrigation. Then exposures have to have different irrigation. Your south and west are going to be a lot drier than your north and east. So they shouldn't be on the same zones. They should be able to water your east side and your north side separately, no matter what it is, even if it's the same plant, even if it's the same turf grass, they should be on different zones. But what do we want when we put in an irrigation system? If we go to the expense of the irrigation system, what do we look at?
We want it easy.
Look at money. That's right. We look at cost. Well, let me tell you, every zone costs more, because then that requires you to have a larger controller and things like that. You should not look at it as cost. And if I could get everybody in here to tell another 3 people, don't look at the cost, then we could conserve a lot more water. Because if you have them zoned correctly, then that's where you're going to be saving the water. I will tell you that turf can use things like these sprays and the rotors. However, sprays and rotors in a landscape bed like this is not appropriate. It should be drip. And you'll have people here say, drip don't work. I'm trying to talk like them, but I'm going to tell you, drip does work, and it does work very, very effectively. TCEQ, the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality, regulates irrigation in the state of Texas. It requires a license in order to be able to install. It also has new rules that came into effect January of 2009. And in those rules of January 2009, that's the big thing that they said. You have to put in appropriate zones. So I will tell you, it's new, like I said, 2009. So, you know, we're getting there, but it's just, it didn't come until 2009. If you have a system that was put in before 2009, there are some things that you can do to renovate it. So you can renovate it. I will tell you, use a licensed irrigator. As a homeowner, you can do your own work, but sometimes a homeowner gets themselves in a lot of trouble doing their own work, that they will actually mess up the system and make it worse than had they just, had an irrigator come out and do it. So there are some things that you can do. Okay, we're going to get to the next principle, which is soil improvement, which is very, very important here. I will tell you, this picture is from eastern Colorado. That's where I used to live. The soils were just as bad there as they are here. They were clay there, just like they are here. And this is basically what the plains look like in a natural state. This is, however, in Dallas, Texas. What you see here is you see this layer of kind of clay and rock. I will tell you that this right here is actually in an area called Lake Highlands. You know where Lake Highlands is? It's over close to White Rock Lake. And this is in a yard in Lake Highlands. Now, these rocks were brought in, but this is what the soil was, okay? So because the soil was so bad, this is a white chalk, and that's why they, you know, you hear about White Rock, White Rock Creek, White Rock this, White Rock, because that's what the rock looks like, and that's what the soil looks like over in that area. So this is what the homeowner was faced with in redoing their landscape. So they made the best of it. I will tell you that this right here is crushed granite. They actually made it into a pathway and decided not to try to plant anything in it, because obviously, unless you get a chisel and a jackhammer, you're not going to be able to make a hole to put a plant in this. So what I'm saying is that sometimes this is what you're faced with in your soil, and if you try to grow something in this, it's not going to grow. It's not going to be conducive to growth. Basically, on the soils in the eastern plains, they can grow buffalo grass. It's a native, and that's basically all that can go there. So here's the thing. In order to have anything in your garden, this is the number one key, no matter what you're doing. If you're doing vegetables, flowers, or landscape, you must prepare that soil. And guess what? It is the least that people think about. But the soil, you've got to think of the soil as the food pantry for the plant, because everything that plant is going to need to survive is in that soil. So if you don't prepare that to begin with, then you're going to have trouble from the whole rest of the time. It's the number one key is soil preparation. And one thing that you can do is do soil amendments. You can rototill. There are some things that you can do to help our clay soil. We have a very tight clay soil here, and on the areas where it's been construction, where there's new homes being put in and things like that, a lot of times it's very, very compacted. That clay may be like concrete. And some people say, oh, well, I'll just add some sand to my clay and I'm going to make sandy loam. Well, that doesn't work. If you mix sand and clay and add a little gravel to it, you have Portland cement, okay? So you need to remember that you never add sand to a clay soil, because that's what you're going to be making is cement. So you're going to make concrete. So what you can do is you can add compost. We make mountains of this yard waste every single year. So we put it in those bags and it goes out, but I will tell you, this is the best amendment that you can use, and you need to use it every year. This is not something that you can put on one time and be good. This is something that is an every year amendment. I don't mean for you to go out there, rototill your yard, and put in compost every year. That's not what I'm meaning. You can use compost in a variety of ways. Even in your turf grass, you can get a fine screened compost for your turf grass that is a really nice, it's called top dressing, and it's a very fine screen that will actually go through your fertilizer spreader, and you can use that on top of your lawns in the spring. It is a great help for the soil. You can aerate that beforehand and then put that down, and it's a great amendment for the soil. So you can do it every single year. You can top dress, you can use it underneath the shrubs, you can use it in your vegetable gardens, you can use it wherever. Compost is something you can use all the time. Now remember, this goes back to exactly what I said before about appropriate plant selection. You got to understand that every plant has a specific environment that it performs best at. And this does not matter, it's really anything. Flowers, vegetables, trees, shrubs, turf grass. Every plant has a specific environment that it likes. So you have to carefully select these to be compatible with the area that you're going to be doing. And then also the irrigation requirements. That is something that comes that people don't think about. They don't think about the soils. They don't think about the irrigation. Oh, it's spraying water, so it works. But really, every plant likes it a little bit different. You don't plant high water use and low water use in the same area. And this is where I see a lot of people going wrong. They love that red yucca that's out on the side of the road, and they plant it right next to their pansies. They are total opposite ends of the water spectrum. That red yucca doesn't need hardly any supplemental water at all. In fact, I've seen red yucca die from too much water. And in some years, we've had red yucca die in the landscape because we've had too much rain. So it can die from too much. Same with the pansies. They require a lot of water. So you don't ever plant them together. You have to do your homework before you do this. Before you go to the garden center, and this is one of the reasons why I wanted to do this month, is to get this word out before you hit the garden centers, before you go out there and you start doing it, that you actually do your homework now. Because there's going to be a lot of things that are going to be coming to those garden centers in March, and people start planting in March. Another thing to realize is that sometimes we can have a late freeze, so don't put stuff out too early. We are in stage 3 water restrictions. Stage 3 does not prohibit you to landscape. However, we are recommending you don't re-landscape until we're back under stage 2 water restrictions. Just simply because there is a chance that we could go to stage 4 if we do not continue with rainfalls and things. If we go to stage 4, you will not be able to water those new landscapes, not even by hand. You will not be able to water your turf. You will not be able to water. The only thing you'll be able to be watered in stage 4 are trees and foundations. So watch to see what's going to happen. I'm hoping that we're not going to go there, but here's the thing now. Even if we go into that and you're not going to be able to plant this year, you can plan. You can do your planning. Because by September, and people don't think about this, they always think about planting in February and March. Like February, March, and April, that's the only time you can plant in Texas. I will tell you that really the best time to plant in Texas is September, October, November. No matter if you're doing turf grass, trees, shrubs, plants, anything. Perennials, that is really the best time to plant. Now, of course, you can't do that with vegetable gardens. You're going to have to grow according to what the summer temperatures are and things like that. You've got summer crops, you've got winter crops. But when you're planning and you're doing this, plan for a variety of textures and colors and things that are going to provide interest in all seasons. If everything blooms in the spring and then you have nothing else the rest of the year, you've kind of got a dull palette of your landscape. So you want to kind of try to do things that are going to do it all year long. Now, appropriate plant selection. This is a picture of the Dallas Arboretum. It's just the most beautiful thing. The Dallas Arboretum has turned into one of the most premier gardens in the United States, and you really need to go look at it. But one thing that you need to take into consideration is that this is an arboretum. It has a staff of 300 in their horticulture. If you want your yard to look like the Dallas Arboretum, you need a staff of 300 to come and maintain it for you, okay? So think about when you're doing this plant selection and how you're going to do it, think about it before you just put it all in. Because some people will think, oh, that's just beautiful. But I know some people will think, oh, that's just ugly. So everybody has a different idea of what's beautiful for them. But one thing about this, this is a perennial garden. One of the things about this particular perennial garden is that it does have a variety of plants that bloom at different color or different times of the season. So what you're seeing now is what's blooming in the fall, but you don't see what's blooming in the spring and the summer in this garden. And I know it's fall because it has some pansies over here in the pot. Now, the other thing about these are the higher water use plants. This is actually a pretty good way to do it. Put those higher use water plants in a pot, in a container, something that you're going to water separately. And this entire bed is actually on drip irrigation. So they've got a drip irrigation that irrigates this entire bed, and then they hand water their pansies in their little pots. So while you might think this is not as beautiful as the arboretum for a backyard situation that has a variety of color all year long, this might be something that you would want to look at. These are some typical plants that you might see that are kind of water wise. These are some standard plants. Purple comb flower, this is called pink skull cap, and I know you can't really see it that well. Yaupon holly and Texas sage. These are kind of a norm plant that has been around for a very, very long time. Drought tolerant, they promote them in a lot of different things. But this is not all you're limited to. You have to realize that there is a huge variety of plants that's available to use, and they can be as bright and colorful. And I will tell you, I used to say this in the xeriscape class, there's no such thing as a xeriscape plant. There's no such thing as a sustainable plant. There's no such thing as a yardwise or earth kind or any of that other stuff. Because here's the thing you need to realize is that even those that are designated earth kind or water wise, if they're not put in the right location, then they won't work for you anyway. So it doesn't really matter if they're termed to certain things. These are just a few things. The big thing you have to realize is, what does it like? Does it like full sun? Does it like part sun? Does it like shade? Because you can't put a full sun plant in part shade or shade, and vice versa. You can't put a full shade plant in the full sun. These are plants for North Texas, so I do mean our full sun here. And there's a lot of ornamental grasses. I just put a few. Really, this talk is not about plants. It's about the whole big picture. So I just put a few just to kind of show you some. But the Mexican feather grass is an ornamental grass, and there's a whole gamut of ornamental grasses that will work in full sun. And we have one that'll work in full shade, and I'll show you that in a minute. But there's a lot of, these are perennials. All of these are perennials that are on here. And a perennial is a plant that is going to come back. An annual is a plant that basically you plant it for that one season and then it goes away. A perennial is where your best bet is, as far as cost-wise is considered. But there's things like four-nerve daisy, blackfoot daisy, and I will tell you, blackfoot daisy, if you give it too much water, it's dead. It likes it dry. It likes it hot. Four-nerve daisy is a little bit more forgiving, but it'll do the same thing. You give any of these plants too much water and they're going to die. Texas primrose, you will see this growing on the side of the road. Some of these are native, some of these are not native. This is called Eupatorium greggii, but you can call it blue mist flower. It is more blue. This picture doesn't do it justice. It is more of a blue colored than this purple colored, but it's called Eupatorium greggii, and I will tell you that this is one that you probably want to put someplace where you can contain it, because if it likes it, it's going to continue to grow and grow. I actually have this one in a container on my patio. But it's still, at these flowers, when they're finished, they put out this seed, and it goes poof. And those seeds end up in my grass, and then we end up in other places that I don't want. And it will come back by seed. The same with the Mexican feathergrass. The Mexican feathergrass puts out those seeds, and it comes up in other places. So. But a Mexican feather is what you see, that thing that looks so wispy in the summertime, and you're driving George Bush and you see this grass on the side of the road that's wisping back and forth. That's Mexican feathergrass. There's also some other grasses out there too. Here's some plants for sun part shade. Okay, so that means that this would not take that full west exposure in North Texas. So this is going to want a little bit of protection from that full heat west sun in August in North Texas. And I will tell you that there's a lot of salvias. There's a Henry Duelberg salvia. There's Salvia greggii. There's a lot of different colors in Salvia greggii. I think there's about 7 or 8 different colors now in this. In the salvias, this is just one in the series. There's a lot of salvias out there. There's Blue Night, Blue Mist, Do This, Do That, Do This. There's a lot of different ones out there. But these are just some examples of some things that you can use in that exposure. This is Gara. It's also called Whirling Butterflies. This picture makes it look like the best plant in the world. It doesn't look that great. In person, it doesn't look that great, but I will tell you that at certain times of the year, it can look pretty great, but the most of the time, it's kind of wispy, kind of like that Mexican feather grass. So Russell Manning is actually a bulb-type plant, something for the spring. And then Zexmania hispida, this is one that is used in a lot of drought-tolerant areas that it will take, but it will not take too much water. So this is one that Zexmania will actually melt out if it has too much water. So shade, there are more for full shade than this, and there are more for all of the others. I'm just trying to give you some that maybe you haven't seen before and some different ones out there. Pigeonberry is actually one that is kind of like a ground cover, and it will work in very, very dense shade. Inland sea oats will work in both part sun to deep, dense shade. It is a grass. It's an ornamental grass. It has a beautiful seed on it that makes a lot of texture and variety for the garden. This is Heuchera. I think you'll call them coral bells is what you'll see them as, coral bells. There's a lot of different varieties in this and a lot of different colors. This is a newer one out called Melting Fire. It's been out a few years, but it's been proven to be pretty tolerant here in this area. And then Turk's Cap. This is the normal Turk's Cap. It comes in a red. There's a new one out called Pam's Pink. So there's a pink variety of Turk's Cap. And Turk's Cap will work in full sun. And let me tell you a little bit about it. When you look at it on the label, it'll tell you it's going to get 3 to 4 foot and 3 to 4 foot spread. If it's got more sun, it'll get 8 foot tall and 8 foot wide. Okay, so take those labels into consideration just a little bit when you do those. These are some other ones that you might see out there. This has been around for a long time, Xeriscape. I will tell you that there is a Xeriscape coined garden at White Rock Lake, and that's where these pictures were taken. So this is the oxeye daisy. It looks about like that. That's about what it looks like in the landscape. I don't think it's one of the prettiest ones around, but they really promote this a lot, and I just don't think it's that pretty. Rose mallow, however, is this pretty. It will look this way as long as it's got its full sun, and not too much water. These all will like it if the soil is a little bit more prepared to get started. Nothing grows well in our deep, dense clay soil. Artichoke thistle, you may see this on the side of the road, but actually it's actually a very unusual plant for the garden. And then yarrow, there's a lot of different varieties of yarrow. This is another one that you wanna watch out for. Make sure you got concrete all around it or it's gonna spread everywhere that you don't want it. This one won't spread. This is purple ice plant. It actually does better in Oklahoma or California. It does the best in California. Ice plant is what's used in California along those hillsides where they wanna try to do a fire break. And that's because it's a succulent plant and it carries a lot of water within those stems, and they will use this plant as a fire break in those hillsides. But it'll work here. It just doesn't bloom all year long here. It usually blooms in the spring, and it blooms really, really nice in the spring. But it does make a nice ground cover, and it is a fire break plant. So if you're concerned about that is something that you can do. Okay. practical turf areas. This is something that nobody does in Texas, because if they have 40 acres, they want 40 acres of manicured grass. Unless you are a turf farm, and that's what this picture is, unless you are a turf farm actually growing this to be cut, to be sold to residential homeowners and to home builders and parks, you don't need this much turf. You really don't. But we have this thing here in Dallas that everything has to be green, and it has to be wall-to-wall green from the sidewalk all the way up, and our whole big old huge acre backyard has to be lush, green, green. I know people here in this area that have got over an acre on their lot that they have finally manicured St. Augustine on the entire acre. Yes, they complain when their water bill comes, but what I'm telling you is that you really don't need it. You need to make turf areas beneficial to the design. And I will tell you something that maybe nobody's told you about with turf, is it's Mother Nature's air conditioner. Turf grass has a cooling effect, and it doesn't matter if we're talking Bermuda grass or we're talking Zoysia, we're talking Buffalo, St. Augustine, whatever. It is a natural cooler. It has a cooling effect. But what we find in a lot of the landscapes is this, that we put it way out away from any of our entertaining areas. We put it way out in the front yard where nobody's going to be near it. We put it way out in the back 40 of that acre to mow it to have this green vista in the background. But if you think of it as the air conditioner and you want to design for conservation, then that's just the opposite. You really want it near your entertaining areas. So if you've got a patio in the back that you want to have guests over for a barbecue and you want to sit out there, you want that turf near your sitting areas. And it's total a backwards thinking from what most people do and from what most people landscape. They put a nice, bright concrete patio. They put their patio table with their umbrella on that patio, and they've got all this concrete around them. And then they wonder why after the 20th of June they can't sit on their back patio anymore. It's hot in Texas. It's hot and it's hot. So you want to make your sitting areas near something that's going to cool. So this is, other than a shade tree, turf grass is the next best air conditioner for you. So you need to make it beneficial to the design. The other thing to realize is that you don't have to have huge areas. It may be small areas. But when you do this design, also think about your maintenance on it. There is a neighborhood that I was driving here in Allen that I'm not even sure where it's at now. I can't quite remember. But it has all these walls in the front. And I'm driving down the street, and there's a stone wall and then turf grass. Stone wall and then turf grass. And I'm going, how did they get a mower on that? Obviously, they're picking up that mower and putting it on there, then starting it and mowing it. You need to think about that when you're doing turf grass. I'm telling you all of those areas, and I'm sure it was the builder's design and the builder did it. But that is the worst place to have turf grass. Number one, it's hard to manage. It's hard to mow. I mean, you always want to think about how you're going to mow, and even if you're not doing it, think about the poor landscape guy that you've hired to mow. How is he going to get that mower to the turf? I've seen people where they do a design where they put the turf right here dead center, and then they put a flower bed all the way around it, and there's no way to drive a mower onto it. You have to physically pick it up and put it on there. So think about that. Even if you're not the one that's going to be mowing it, think about the person who is going to be mowing it and make sure that you've got access for the mower to come from a hard surface, such as a sidewalk or a driveway, right onto the turf area. If you put stepping stones and gravel that the mower has to go over, you're going to be, if you start that mower and go over it, you're going to be shooting gravel everywhere because that mower is going to pick up that gravel. So think about that. Make it beneficial to the design. As far as alternative turf varieties, these are the ones that they recommend. I will tell you, you will see this a lot of times. You'll say, buffalo grass, that is the drought tolerant. That's what you need. That's what everybody needs. And I'm here to tell you, if you're in a home lawn situation and you have got a neighbor on either side that has got Bermuda or St. Augustine, you do not want buffalo grass, okay? You want buffalo grass if you're on that acre and you do not have manicured St. Augustine coming right up next to it. That's where you want buffalo. Because the more you do to buffalo, the worse it grows. Buffalo is a pasture grass. It grows naturally on the prairie. It likes to be left alone. It doesn't want to be mowed. It doesn't want to be watered. It doesn't want to be fertilized. And it certainly does not want any weed killers on it at all. So buffalo grass is that grass that you want out there where you're not going to water it, you're not going to mow it, you're not going to do anything to it, you're going to let it go. And it will not tolerate a lot of traffic. So if you have the football team over to practice, buffalo is not the one that you want because it's not going to tolerate pounding of football players over it and over it and over it. So you will see this a lot of times and a lot of the Xeriscape and a lot of things will recommend buffalo grass. I'm here to tell you, if you're in a home lawn situation, you do not want it unless your neighbors have got it too and you do the whole neighborhood this way to where you can leave it alone. If you currently have St. Augustine or you are thinking about putting in St. Augustine, then I'm here to say please don't. It uses more water and requires more water and it will not work in deep shade. No turf grass will work in deep shade. And they'll say, but the landscaper told me, well, the nursery told me, well, the lawn care service and the turf grass place told me that St. Augustine is what I wanted for my shady spot. Even Palisade Zoysia will not grow in deep shade. Turf grass requires 4 hours of sunlight, whether it is the most shade tolerant St. Augustine or the most shade tolerant Zoysia, it still requires 4 hours of sunlight. So if it's in an area where it's deep dark shade underneath trees that are very, very dense, don't try to grow turf grass there. It just won't grow. I saw a newscast on one of the channels couple of weeks ago where a person in Plano was complaining about the water restrictions because it had killed their landscape. Their landscape was dead and it had killed it because of the water restrictions. Well, I took great offense to that, you know I would, because I'm a water conservation manager, but that's not what killed that landscape. It had nothing to do with the water restrictions. There was a Japanese yew that they were showing and they were showing Bermuda grass underneath a tree. Bermuda grass will not grow under a tree ever. It wasn't water restrictions that killed those plants. The yew was killed from the 109 degrees in August because it does not like 109 degrees, especially in full sun. That's what killed that. The Bermuda was killed from the shade of that tree. So it had nothing to do with water restrictions, and sometimes I just have to say it. There's some stores here in Allen that sell the fine fescues for shade. They also sell ryegrass. And I will tell you that the city of Allen has an ordinance against planting cool season grasses because cool season grasses do not grow well here. None of them do. Fescue grows the best. However, fescue has to be reseeded each year because if we have 109 degrees, typically it's going to kill out. The only one that doesn't kill out is the turf type tall fescue, and it will muddle through in the summer. But it basically browns totally out and you have nothing there in the summer, and then it starts turning green again in the winter, just when we really want to mow our grass. That's when it does it. So, and I'll just tell you the reason for that ordinance. It takes 8,000 gallons for every 1,000 square feet of perennial rye, because that's typically what they use for overseeding, in order to get it established and get it growing through the season. So if we didn't do it, That would be 8,000 gallons per 1,000 square feet that we save. Let me just talk a little bit about Palisade Zoysia. This is the actual picture of it. The blade is a little bit thinner than St. Augustine. It will grow in the same areas that St. Augustine will grow, meaning 4 hours of sunlight. It is does not require as much water. It does not require as much maintenance. It's a little bit slower growing than St. Augustine. So that means that you have to mow less. Don't we just love to mow? You know, this is the only thing that I see as a culture of what we do in North Texas. As we grow this turf grass and we put all of this fertilizer and all of this water so that it grows so that we can mow it back off. And we just continue doing this, you know, it's just like it. And I'm a very lazy gardener. I don't like to. So I want to do anything that doesn't require that. I will tell you that the more water and the more fertilizer you give any grass other than buffalo, because it doesn't like it, is going to make it grow. If you do not want to mow it, don't put fertilizer, don't put water on it. If you want to slow it down, do less. So if you want it to be slow, to where you're only mowing once a week instead of twice a week, then you cut back on the water, you cut back on the turf. And I will tell you, there's not a single, if you're using Bermuda grass, which this particular one here is called Celebration, it's a newer variety that is a little bit more tolerant of some shade. And realize it says dappled shade. This is a mesquite tree. Do you guys know what a mesquite and what the fine leaves are on a mesquite tree? Realize that a mesquite tree is not going to give out a tremendous amount of shade. And I actually pulled this off of their website of their ad for Celebration Bermuda. It will not work in dense shade. It will only work in that dappled shade area. So if you're wanting a Bermuda grass that is a little bit more shade tolerant, then this is a variety that you want to look for. As far as shade, if you've got very, very dense shade around this, then this grass is not going to make it, and most Bermuda is not going to make it. And even though the home builder puts Bermuda down, even on those east sides where it's 100% shade, it's only gonna be there until the warranty's up, and then, you know, it won't be there. So you need to realize that. The other thing to realize is that when you have a lawn like this and you have trees, and this is typical of Allen, where we might have a tree dead center and a tree dead center, you really don't want that turf grass all the way up to the trunk of the tree. It's not good for the tree. And if you have irrigation systems spraying onto the trunk of that tree, it's not good. I pulled this off of theirs, but I thought it was kind of weird because really, mesquite does not require a lot of supplemental water. So if you were really heavy fertilizing this and heavy watering this, you're probably going to kill that mesquite tree. Trees, basically, if you've got a tree that's gotten very, very large and nothing grows under it, you need to think about mulching it. Okay, just some things. Remember, there are alternatives to turf. You don't have to do turf. You can do ground covers. Think of it in areas that you mow. If you've got a very, very narrow spot, why run a mower through it? You could use something else. Or if you wanted to just use the turf grass as your pathway and you use a very tolerant turf grass, then it can become pathways to lead you through your garden to where you can have all of these other nice perennial gardens and things through it. So it's all about design at that very beginning. These are things you really want to consider. Remember that wall I talked about? If it's going to be difficult to mow, then don't use a turf grass. There are other things you can use. And those particular areas would be much better with a ground cover that never had to be maintained at all. It would be much, much more beneficial. So if it's impractical to mow, if there's steep slopes where it may be very difficult to mow, hot and dry areas near walls or deeply shaded areas, use something other than turf. And then also improve the soil before planting. A lot of people think, I just scrape that soil clean and I slap that sod right down, because it comes in those little squares like carpet and you just throw it down. If you don't prepare the soil, the turf's not going to do well on it either. So, okay, I've talked a little bit about irrigation before, but these are the things that you have to have in order to have an efficient irrigation system. see this spray that's come up, and I will tell you that this is some zinnias and maybe some lantana, and there's some dusty miller down here. This is just a flower bed. Which one of these are efficient irrigation? Neither one are efficient, because this spraying on that flower is not efficient, and it is not good for that plant. That plant would do much better with drip irrigation, with water down at the base. If you're continually spraying water on here, then especially for a zinnia, you're going to end up with a disease called powdery mildew or another fungal disease because you've constantly got water spraying on it. This is true for roses. It's true for a lot of things. Even those vegetable gardens that we have, tomatoes and things like that, they do much better with irrigation down at the base. This one, of course, very obvious. You got water running in the street. You've got more water running in the street than you do in this median area. And it's pretty obvious from this picture. This spray only goes to there. And it should be going to there. And the one along the other side should be meeting it. But I will tell you, for a median area where you're surrounded with concrete like this, you should not have spray irrigation, because this is where all of the waste comes from. It runs down. And for Allen, this is not a picture of Allen, but I will tell you, you could go through Allen on a water day and actually any neighborhood, and you might find as much water on the streets as what this picture shows. And how this is so wasteful for Allen is that we don't recapture any of this water. It goes in the storm drain. It goes, eventually leads to Rowlett Creek. It eventually leads to Lake Ray Hubbard. Lake Ray Hubbard is not a water source for Allen. Lake Lavon is. So there, in essence, every time you run your system and you allow water to go down the street like this, you're actually giving our good water to those nice folks in Dallas. So we're not getting it back. So you got to think about that. We don't want to see any water runoff. And if it means that the only way that this can water is with water runoff, then you need to change the plant material to something that does not require that water. Since 2009, that parkway area between the street and the sidewalk is required to have drip. It is not allowed to have above ground sprays such as this now. And that's the reason. Because when you put a spray along a curb line, you're going to have it running off the curb into the street. If you have a shrub zone, okay, meaning, or a flower bed zone, meaning that the only spray heads that are in this are all on one circuit. There, you don't have anything else coming up in the grass or something else coming up over here. They're all coming up in here. This can be converted to drip without digging up the valve, without digging up everything. Okay, obviously I talk a lot about irrigation because where does the water go? Through the irrigation. It's a very, very important thing to do. You have to have that efficient design and proper installation to begin with. Then you have to maintain it. A sprinkler system is not maintenance free. In fact, in my home in Colorado, a friend of mine, she watched me with my sprinkler system and she goes, "You know, I wanted one of those until I saw how much work you spend on, or how much time you spend working on yours, because they are constant maintenance." This is what that spray head can look like in just a few years. It may have started out looking like this, and this is the way that it should look, that it pops up and it sprays. If it's doing this and that head, that stem is not coming up, then it's time to maintain that sprinkler head. That sprinkler head needs to be raised. You need to physically dig that out and raise it up to where the spray is like that. So it has to have maintenance. And the third is to schedule water-wise. Now, you do not have to have an ET controller in order to do water-wise. Any controller, you can schedule it to make it water-wise. But the first thing that you're going to have to do is find out how much the system gives out. And the only way that you can do that is you can put out, these are little catch can cups, but you can use tuna cans or cat food cans or even those little Rubbermaid or those little Gladware containers. Just as long as they're all the same size and all the same shape, you can just put them out in a little grid. You don't even have to put this many out there, but you can put them out there and you can run your sprinkler for about 5 minutes, and then you can figure out how much water has been run in 5 minutes. And then from there, you can determine and set your controller. Here's how you schedule it. You've got to give the zone the correct amount of time to water. You've got to make seasonal adjustments. Just because you set it for your hottest time in August does not mean it's going to be the same that you're going to run it in all of the rest of the months. So you have to do seasonal adjustments to it. You also need to use rain and freeze sensors because that's going to help to turn this thing off when it's raining or freezing outside. And you don't want to be doing that if it's raining. The other thing is to time the irrigation between midnight and 6 a.m. This is the best time for less evaporation. So even after 6 p.m. at night is not as good as between midnight and 6 a.m. There is less evaporation during the summer months than there is the winter months. Realize our temperatures are cooler and you do not have as much evaporation. That your watering time is from midnight to 11:59 on that day. But we did have a lot of confusion. People thought they said, well, you wrote that wrong on there because we can't water between 10 a.m. and 6 p.m. Yes, you can, between November and March. However, after that, starting April 1st to October, there is no 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. watering because that's when the temperatures start to get warmer and we've got more daylight and more sun and we're going to have more evaporation. So that's when we don't want to water. You need to be going out there and checking it. You just don't set it and forget it. And if that means on Saturday morning that you're out there and you turn it on for a 1 minute test and you walk through the system and you look to see, that's how you do that. And you check, and you do need to check. And you need to check, and if you have a lawn service that comes and mows for you, you need to check the next day after they mow. Because there is a great possibility that they ran over a sprinkler head or cut into one by an edger or a mower. And so if you have a lawn service, now if you're doing it, you're going to know when you hit it because that mower is going to clunk, clunk, and you're going to know. But if you've got a lawn service out there doing it, you're not going to know. And it's very easy to run over a head or nozzle or do something. So if you have a lawn service, then get in the habit. Whatever day that they do the lawn work, that evening, run through the system and check to see if there's any broken heads. Water-wise equipment, there's a whole lot of new stuff out there. Why? Because water is the focus right now across the entire United States. We have a limited supply, and some areas are even more limited. So the irrigation companies, they know they're the ones that's like, they're being picked on. No, they're really not. It's just that these are items where waste can occur without people knowing it. Because just like you said, not knowing that somebody cut through it, not knowing that the lawn care company did something with the mower, not knowing that it's not running. If you don't check it, then you won't know. And I will tell you, it doesn't matter. All of the ETs or all of the other water-wise equipment that you get will not stop water waste if you're not checking that irrigation system on a regular basis. So regular basis. Do you have to be an irrigator to do it? No, but anybody knows if a sprinkler is shooting a geyser 60 feet in the air, there's something wrong. This is a fact that was put out by EPA that said 24 billion gallons a year could be saved if weather-based irrigation controllers were used. And these are controllers that basically will put out water only based on the ET, or the evapotranspiration rate, of the plant. They all have to be set. They are not foolproof. They're not one that you can set and just leave it alone. They still can have problems. Things like their little on-site weather stations can lose communication with their controller. And you won't know it, and it's going off when it shouldn't be. It might be raining outside, and it's going off because it's lost communication. And that happens with those little rain sensors, too. So that's another item to know about. So how many of you know how much water you use? Do you look at your water bill? Okay. There's a consumption box on there. Okay? So on your water bill, you should be able to find out how much you use. Check it this month. And if you have an automatic irrigation system, check it in August. So you can quickly see where your water goes to, all right? So you can see very, very quickly. I will tell you, of course, I'm the water conservation manager. My consumption was 1,200 gallons this last month. Okay, 1,200, not 12,000, 1,200. I will tell you there's a new website out there. The Alliance for Water Efficiency has got a computer calculator, and you can just Google Alliance for Water Efficiency. Those of you that receive e-news from the city, you should have gotten a link to it yesterday. It was in our e-news. But it has a calculator that you can actually go to see how you do according to the rest of the United States. So you can kind of, it'll estimate if you've never really thought about it, and it'll see how much you use. But just so you know, and this will tell you how well you do, the average water annual use on lawns, now this is all the way across the United States, average water use is 67,000 per household a year, okay? It's more in arid climates where you have desert and people are trying to grow bluegrass in the desert. Now, I bring this to you, realize this is annual. We have a lot of accounts in Allen that use more than 67,000 in a month. And where do you think that 67,000 is going? To Dallas. It's going down the street. You know it's going on the landscape. You know a good percentage of it if they do not have a leak. The average indoor use per person per day is 70 gallons. So you can kind of figure this out by knowing if you look at your consumption on your bill and you divide it by how many people are in your household and divide it by how many days there were in that billing cycle, that will tell you how many gallons you use per day. This is the average across the United States. So you can go home and find out how well you do. One of the reasons why our water conservation department in Allen spends so much of its time on things like the Sustainable Landscape Series and outdoor is because 50 to 60% of that water goes to lawn and landscape watering, and 50% may be wasted due to the inefficient systems, to those broken heads, to misuse, or people that just really don't know. I will tell you, if you have an older irrigation controller and it has one of those little 9-volt battery backups, you need to change those every time you change your batteries and your smoke alarm. It's basically the same thing. If your power goes out and your irrigation system is set to run, it will try to run off that battery and it will drain that battery immediately. And then if the power goes out the next time, it resets. And that clock typically resets to midnight. And it typically resets every single zone to come on 7 days a week for 10 minutes. It's a default programming that a lot of the older controllers have. Some of the newer ones don't have that. They have lithium batteries now and they last a lot longer. But those older ones have that. So you really need to check that because that could be where some of the waste is. Okay, down to our principle of mulch. I will tell you that even rocks can be used as a mulch. But basically anything, compost, wood chips, pecan shells, bark, even ground newspaper, anything that you have available can be used as a mulch. Grass clippings can be used as a mulch, but I will tell you, Bermuda grass seeds can be viable in those grass clippings, and you could get Bermuda coming up in your beds if you do that. So, but mulch is something that is going to help. Typically, you're going to want to put about a 3-inch layer of mulch, and I'm going to show you something in just another second here. And then while we want all landscapes, we don't want to do any maintenance. There is no such thing as a maintenance-free landscape unless you're talking concrete. Because even those things with the weed barrier and gravel or whatever else requires maintenance. Because soil blows in the air, weed seeds blow in the air, then they germinate on top of that gravel, and then you've got weeds. So everything is not maintenance-free. We'd love for it to be, but it's just everything requires it. And when you're doing your planning for whatever it is that you want for your landscape, that's a question to ask yourself. How much time do I have to spend on maintenance? Do I have 600 people that work for me to maintain it to look like the Dallas Arboretum? No, okay, well, how much time do you really have? And really think about this. Well, you know, I really like to get out there and dabble in it, maybe a couple of hours a month. Then that's the landscape you need. Something that only requires a couple of hours a month. I have had people that buy these beautiful, lush homes, and they've got this lush landscaping and everything is just gorgeous and gorgeous, and they bought it because it looked like that. And then after they were in there 3 months, they couldn't figure out why it was all dying. And it didn't look so beautiful anymore. And that's because they didn't have the time to maintain it and they didn't hire somebody to do it for them. So that's the thing. It's going to require maintenance and you have to know what it is that you're going to do. Now, there's a lot of other things out there. I'm just going to go quickly over some don'ts for appropriate maintenance. When we're talking about mulch, we're not talking about mulch volcanoes. And I see this all the time. Here's that tree trunk, and they have put, if 3 inches is good, 12 ought to be great. Let's put 12 inches along that trunk. You don't ever want to see this. You do never want to see this up the trunk. Never put mulch on the trunk, because what it does is it softens that wood and it causes an entry for diseases and insects and rats and mice and other rodents get up there and chew on that bark because it's now soft and lovely and they can bury up underneath there. So you don't want to do that. That's a big no-no for mulch volcanoes. Lawn scalping. This is something that has been a common practice in Texas since I know I was a little kid here in Texas, and every spring everybody got out there with their lawnmowers and they put it down the lowest notch that they could, and they wear a gas mask. You see this guy has and then they have 45 brown bags of dead grass that they've now, because they bagged it, they're bagging all this, and they put it in there, and then it goes and becomes compost, and then you buy it back as compost. This is something that is not necessary at all, ever. And Jim McAfee, who is the turf grass extension specialist for Texas A&M, will say the benefits of this, of scalping, is to remove enough of that layer to allow the sun to penetrate, to warm up the soil, to green up the grass. Why do you want your grass green in April and you have to start mowing it? Because the lawn service gets money. But I will tell you, this is not necessary. It's not a necessary practice for Bermuda grass. It's not a necessary practice for St. Augustine, for Zoysia, or any of those. It is not necessary. I will tell you, I can show you lawns. You can put one right next to each other. One has been scalped. One has not been scalped. And they just kind of waited for it to green up on its own. Come June 15th, you can't tell the difference in the lawns. This one didn't green up that fast. However, by June 15th, it was just as green and growing just as perfect as the one that was scalped. So why would you want to go through this trouble and all of this waste if it's not necessary? Here's what I recommend. That instead of scalping and taking it all the way down, that you do what's called a cleanup mow. If you normally mow on notch number 3 of your mower, put it on notch number 2. So just bring it down 1, whatever that notch is, just what you normally mow. And do that cleanup, but it's too early right now. You do not need to do it before April, ever. You can do that cleanup, and you can do that, and then you can start your regular maintenance from that point on. And that's really all you need to do. And you don't even need to bag it. Because that will just, You're going to, and I will tell you, everybody says, you got to remove that dead stuff. It's not dead, it's dormant. It's not dead, it's dormant. You're removing some of that layer. If you actually cut it and allow that to stay on there, what you have is compost. Because it's going to decompose and go down into the soil and just help you with some compost. So you don't need to bag it. You never need to bag, period. And then this is a practice that I'm already seeing. This is should never, never, ever, ever, ever be done. This is called crepe myrtle. This is a crepe myrtle, and for some reason people have it in their head because it blooms on new wood, that must mean I have to cut it all the way down to get these nice flowers. That is not true. It's absolutely not true. And you should not ever be cutting it like this. It makes all these ugly stumps, and it comes out all this ugly growth, and then you'll start having all of this sucker at the base, because you keep killing it, and it's trying to survive. I'm trying to survive. I'm going to shoot up as many shoots as I can just to survive, because you've murdered the top of me. This is a properly pruned crepe myrtles. They don't need it at all, period. They will grow whether you do anything to them or not. They will flower. No matter if you do anything or not, they will continue to flower. However, if you just insist and have to have it pruned, then this is a proper pruning job of that crepe myrtle. And typically what they've done is they've taken out any wayward crossing branches or anything that's moving, and then what they've done is they've taken the old seed heads off from last year. But it's not necessary. You don't have to do it. But if you want to, you can do it. And that's the way you properly prune it. You never prune it like that, ever. So these are the do's. You can do it this way. You don't have to. But if you're going to do it right. Prune it the right way. The other thing that you want to do, of course, is repair those broken sprinkler heads. This is, some people say, well, that's not that much waste. Well, no matter whatever size pipe that is that's underneath there that's going to allow the flow, it's going to flow as much as it can. So this could be flowing 30 gallons per minute. Your meter typically doesn't like to have more than 15 gallons per minute flowing out of it. So if you've got twice as much coming out of a broken sprinkler head, then you're taxing that meter as well. And if you have your meter break, then you might have a high, there's just no telling what'll happen with that meter at that point. It might start spinning. But the thing is, 30 gallons per minute. And if you've got a 15-minute run time on that sprinkler zone, quickly you can see how much waste that you can have from one broken sprinkler head. So imagine if you have 20 broken sprinkler heads on the lawn at the same time. Like I said before, compost, compost, compost. Everywhere, each year, you can use this just like you would bark, mulch, or anything else. It can just be a nice top dressing or whatever. You can put it down anytime. It's really, here's the thing. You can put it down in the wintertime. You can put it down in the hot summertime. You know, it's not going to hurt to put it down in the summer. It's not going to hurt to put it down in the wintertime. I typically mulch when I'm not doing anything else. So if I'm wanting to get out there in the garden and do something, and it's too early to do this or too late to do this, it's never too early or late to do mulch or compost. Just make sure you never smother the plant. So when you're putting this compost down, this is something that you want to think about. With this tree right here, what you want to do is you want to spread that mulch to a diameter of at least 3 foot and a depth of 3 to 4 inches. That's if you're going to mulch a tree, if you're going to mulch shrubs, if you're going to mulch perennials or anything like that. Never smother them. Remember that volcano? You don't ever want to smother your plants with compost or mulch, because that's exactly what you will be doing. As you will be smothering it. So you want to have a nice 3 to 4 inch depth, and if it's a tree, we're talking at least 3 feet. And this means that in that 3 foot area, don't allow turf grass to try to grow, even on a new tree. And as this tree gets older and it gets dense, more dense canopy, this mulch layer may end up being a lot bigger. But if by mulching it, you're not having to try to keep the weeds out from underneath the tree and things like that. And it will only be beneficial. Now, and I say 3 to 4 inch depth, because if you put 10 inches, you're going to smother the roots as well. So even if it's away from that trunk, if it's this deep, you're going to change where that root for that tree has been breathing. So you can do this every year, and it really doesn't matter what time of year that you do. A lot of times it's availability of the compost and the mulch. Typically the spring, you're going to find it everywhere. All of the places have it. They'll have it on sale, and just like the Texas Pure, February is the month that they have it on sale. The internet has got a wealth of information on it. However, it is the World Wide Web. Not everything that works in Chicago, Illinois, or Washington, D.C. is going to work here. You have to really pay attention to the advice you're getting on that website. Is it from a source that is reliable? Is it Jane Doe's gardening that she did, puts up blog posts that she's just a homeowner? Or is it somebody that is actually in the industry? Is it somebody that is actually research oriented that will give you the best information? I will tell you that Texas A&M University is the land grant institution for Texas. Every state has a land grant institution, and that is where you will find the scientific, very research studied, latest, greatest tips for anything pertaining to the landscape, the garden, or anything agriculture, because those are where it's going to be. And as far as Texas is concerned, it is aggiehorticulture.tamu.edu. has got everything that you would need to know as far as varieties that would work here, for vegetable gardens, for flower gardens, for perennials, for shrubs, for trees, for turf. It's all on there. And it's a huge website. You could probably spend days on that one website just looking at all of the other thing. And if you want it more local, this is the Collin County Extension Office. This is the Extension Office for Collin County, and it's in McKinney. We do have a full-time horticulture agent in Collin County. His name is Dr. Greg Church, and he has got lots of information listed here at this website if you want particular for Collin County. So those are the things, those are the trusted sites. There's a lot of other sites out there, but these are the ones that you're going to get the latest, greatest, scientifically proved information for your landscape. Well, obviously, I guess you got your money's worth, so you're welcome.